Episode 6 in a Bleach gives us a lot to talk about within this review, and to be honest with you, calling it a review would be a bit of an injustice considering it's probably going to turn into a discussion more so towards the end of, well, actually Shinji as well, but more so Ichigo, because that's what people are probably more likely here for. So we'll get through the episode, I'll give you my thoughts, and then we'll deep dive into Ichigo, I suppose, because again, a lot to talk about. So please like, subscribe and share the video, and of course comment in the comment section down below, it always helps me out. And yeah, let's get into this. It's going to be a busy day. So first and foremost, I do want to give an appreciation to this episode as a whole, because many war arcs don't feel like a war arc, and this gives it a sense of life. This episode gives it a sense of life by showing us captains, lieutenants doing their thing, of course, but also giving us foot soldiers running around as an actual war is going on. You got Hisage running, you got Isane hiding from the enemies, trying to heal as many injured soldiers as she possibly can. You got Momo, you got Iba doing things. Granted, nothing at all in this episode that they've done, but they go and show a little bit of a sense of struggle, to which I appreciate. And of course as well, Shuhei getting lost in the terrain, because the terrain's completely different. So it's those little things that contribute just a sense of life within this war, or lack of life. And while we all do love a good old fight, and we do love fights in general and plot twists, it is important to also show a little bit of notice to those in the background as well, and things that are happening while a war is going on, because again, that's what a war is. A lot of fodder are going to actually die in the interim of all of it, and it gives it a sense of realism. Then of course we hop over to Shiro's scene getting reused, of course, with Basby, but from a little bit of a different perspective. So I wasn't completely mad at reusing of shots there, and just like I said before, we've given a life of what's going on. It also gives us a sense of time as well, given that when Toshiro got hit, all these things are happening with the other people as well. So it gives us a sense of what else was happening during that time when Toshiro got hit. And of course, might I just add as well, that scene of Toshiro that I'm going to show on screen right now, absolutely detailed for just no reason. Like, they didn't have to go hard on his hair there. I don't know. It looks nice. Absolutely. It just, one of those things that people in general just notice, whether it would be live reactors or people on Twitter or people in the comment section, they just notice that Toshiro looked really high definition here, and it's nice. Unnecessary, but I appreciate it. Then, of course, a big thing that threw people off was Rangiku Matsumoto. Is she dead or is she not? And, of course, this kind of got really exploded by Kubo's tweet, which, of course, if you don't know, when somebody dies in Bleach, Kubo goes out of his way to draw an illustration of that character, specifically on the week of their death. However, while we do see most of these characters that Kubo draws as a portrait and a solid coloured background, we do, however, see Rangiku have her own spotlight, but this time having like this almost mirror effect with two different colours looking like there's a split. And this, to me, I interpreted it as in between of life and death. So, of course, many people doing posted, many people were obviously freaking out, but of course it is different from all the other photos that we've ever had. So I do appreciate the show not tell kind of idea there, even though, but of course I do appreciate that nonetheless. And of course Toshiro didn't get one either, so maybe it just goes to show that Matsumoto is more in a severe situation than meets the eye. Then again, she did look like she was pretty much dead, but hey-ho. I do also want to bring up the fact as well of Toshiro having his flower petals on his bankai. Don't really know why I wrote this note down. I just kind of wanted to bring it up, because Kangdu didn't really have any, but Toshiro does. And yes, it is the same in the manga as well. And my conclusion to this is that Kangdu has a full body, full grown body that could probably take the power of Toshiro's his bankai, while Toshiro himself doesn't have that body that he's capable of producing that bankai. So maybe that's why Kangdu didn't have the petals and maybe Toshiro does. But we'll probably find out later on in probably Core 4. So just a little nod to anyone that wants to think about that. And I think it's pretty interesting, a little bit of attention to detail there. And then, of course, we get to the majority of the episode, which I found was the most boring part. And I'll explain why. As a manga reader, been there, done that, knew all this, wasn't really new to me. But of course, if you're an anime only, of course, the reaction is going to be different. Most of what I enjoyed was actually Kisuke and Mayuri's interactions with each other and the banter that came along with it. I do feel like it was over-explained a little bit with Kisuke coming to the realization of what the Bankai stealing weakness was. But weirdly enough, at the same time, it gave enough detail to which explained it thoroughly. To which is in something of Kisuke's character as well as Mayuri's. They love to really go in detail with things. So having these two people who are extremely detailed about what they do and what they see makes a lot of sense. And of course, if you had a hard time explaining it, basically, the Quincy's are destroying Hollows because they are a threat to the Quincy's themselves, because they have no antibodies towards Hollows, so they deem them a threat to the Quincy life, so that's why they destroy them, as well as the reason why they couldn't take their resurrections, because they are similar to Bankai's, but they didn't take them because they don't have antibodies and it's poisonous to them, and Kurge OP was a prime example of this solution. But might I just add as well, Mayuri with the RGB lights, with the water cooling. there was many theories to why it went this direction. Of course, it could go on the theory of, well, if it was all yellow, then of course it would completely be blinded within the completely white room that they're in. It might be a bit too distracting or maybe too saturated, and the different colors could basically deviate from that. Or it could be mood lights, where Mayuri's mood changes depending on the color of which he has. Yellow being a superior, while multicolored means changing mood depending on what Kisuke is saying. It's a possibility. There's something to do with like light theory as well. And yeah, I mean, it doesn't really matter. I think it looks cool. I like the direction. Have no issues there. I do think whatever conclusion you guys come up with personally is kind of valid. So have fun with it. It's there. Enjoy it. Now on to a little bit of complaining. And this is a little bit of a two-parter because I want to talk about Shinji a little bit in regards to the Hollow Pill as well. But for the Hollow Pills, how did they get within the areas of where every Shinigami or every Shinigami with a Bankai is? Now, I personally concluded it to those little flying mini bots that, you know, Mayuri has to hack into the systems, and they were flying all around the Serete to drop these pills. Granted, within a quick amount of time, in fact, extremely quick, mind you, but it almost seems simultaneously with the communications Kido that Kisuke uses to contact every captain. So is there more usage with the communication Kido that we just don't know about, which allows things to be teleported to some places? Was the forbidden Kido of teleportation used? Probably doubt that, but also I guess one thing that did bother me is not the fact that they were all dispersed across the Soul Society, but isn't Byakuya still in the Soul Palace? So you're telling me it's not Mayuri's bugs, because Mayuri's bugs are definitely not in the Soul Palace for sure. So how did the pill get to the Soul Palace for Byakuya to touch it? And is the Kido that strong that it was able to reach to Byakuya? And if it is, maybe it is a Kido diff. Maybe there is more to the communication of Kido that we don't know, but I did find it a little bit of an issue. Is he in the Soul Society at this point? I highly doubt, but still, it does make the brain ponder a little bit. But that's my only pet peeve. You can really surmise it down to Kido that we just don't know of yet, and it probably won't be explained. So that is a little bit of a pet peeve for me. Was in the manga, was now. Is it a game changer? Not really. It doesn't really kill the story for me, but still. And then another one is, we still don't know BG9 script, and I'll use someone of what someone said in the comment section in one of my last live reactions, is it is probably K for the knowledge. Hopefully we actually find out what his script is, but considering you are the knowledge and he analyzes a lot of his enemies and analyzes a lot of things in general, the fact that he didn't acknowledge that maybe that they would use Hollow Pills is probably, he's not doing his script very well. So yeah, I don't know. BG9 is, hopefully we see more, maybe, copium. However, I can't stress enough how much I love Soifan's voice acting when she used her Bankai, because when she said Jakaho Raikuben, it genuinely sounded like there was pain when she said that Raikuben. Like, Raikuben! Like, it sounded like there was pain within that last stretch of her Bankai's name, and I just wanted to bring it up because I quite liked it. Maybe I'm just hearing differently, I don't know. I just really liked how it was said and pronounced. But I think everybody agrees that throughout this episode, the one thing that was very chilling was that massive explosion. I can't thank Eva Koya enough for that shot. Greatly animated, beautiful. Shame that a few frames got cut out, but Sakai came in to do some corrections, added more to the explosion, and to be honest with you, French fucking kiss. Amazing, beautiful, gorgeous. And especially the size of it too was really shows the devastation of Soifan's Bankai, and I can't express that enough. Like, we had it with Barragon and it was pretty big, but to this extent was another level. Then we have Toshiro versus Shengdu, and I'm going to try and call him Shengdu instead of Kangdu, as something I've been saying for 10 years until recently. So, because people keep saying, oh, it's Shengdu, not Kangdu. And I'll try. Just like with Vol standing, not Vol, Vol stand. It doesn't matter. I'm trying, right? It's a 10-year plus habit. Give me a break. So we have Toshiro versus Shengdu, and to be honest with you, again, not really much to say about this fight. I did like the animation added. I did like, obviously, Toshiro having his holified Bankai, and to be honest with you, the thing that I appreciate the much amongst all the great animation that was in that fight was the reverb of the Hollow voice, and it really gave me a little bit of a tingle of that, like, back in the day Hollow Ichigo Mask voice, and it was mwah, French kiss again, love that. I'm not really gonna go too much into the fight because it is exactly what it was a fight. Toshiro got his Bankai, does his thing, ends it, great. I think what the more important thing is who is that came up to Toshiro when he fell down? We get a shadow. Now, at first I thought it was Jodombo. The reason why I say Jodombo is because Giselle makes people into zombies, and those zombies, you know, are going to be used as foot soldiers. You can't expect Giselle to go around every single soldier or every single captain or every single lieutenant on the battlefield and then individually turn them into a zombie. Chances are is that whoever she's made into a zombie is going around picking people up, taking them to a spot, and then Giselle will go there, turn them all into zombies, and then bing bam bosh, saves them a lot of issue from turning them into zombies. So I don't think it is GG, considering that we do see them with the Bambi group, like, literally in a few frames or a few scenes. So I'm not convinced that it's Giselle. So then again, I don't think it's Jodombo either, because I did think, oh well, maybe his shadow is being cast from far away. But considering that I listened to it again and the footsteps landed fairly close to Toshiro, it is obviously not Jodombo, but someone, you know, of human size. So yeah, beats me. Who do you guys think it is? Tell me in the comment section down below. Then let's talk about the pills with the visors. Of course, in this case, Shinji, before we get to his beautiful Bankai. Somebody brought up to me that maybe it was a contradiction, that maybe that Shinji didn't need a hollow pill considering that he has hollow abilities or a hollow mask. Well, this may be the case without going too deep into lore, because I don't want to make this video long. The holification with the visors is completely different in regards to the holification of Ichigo, so to say. Ichigo's his source, or his spiritual pressure, is his holification and Shinigami abilities. Shinji's, on the other hand, his hollow abilities are separate from his Shinigami abilities. So where, yes, he can use the hollow mask, but his Bankai ultimately is 100% Shinigami. So in that regard, technically, and again, you can debate me on it, of course, I'm happy to be wrong, but from my experience with Bleach, I do lean on the side of two different souls here. His mask is an external soul, it's an external reishi, it's not combined with Shinigami powers. So that being said, it would seem to me that taking the Bankai from Shinji is still viable without being poisoned, per se. And that's my explanation to that. You can take it or leave it. Then, of course, we get onto Shinji's Bankai. Now, of course, it is exactly as I expected Shinji's Bankai to be. The CGI was nice. And, of course, people are complaining a little bit because it is a little bit different in the light novels, because in the light novels, we do see it kind of spread out. Now, could this be in regards to the difference of the hollow pill that made it close and made it different? Of course, I don't know, to be honest with you. There was no reverb like it was with Toshiro. There was no difference in the Bankai like there was again with Toshiro. So we can't really tell for sure. Again, Shinji's Bankai is still a little bit of an anomaly. There's probably more to his Bankai than just, you know, closing and then making enemies attack each other. There's probably more to his Bankai than just that. Bankais are very complicated things with very various attacking factors. And I probably think that maybe the Bankai that we saw within the light novels is probably in the anime not at its full potential. And that was probably just enough for those foot soldiers. So I still think there is a little bit of a mystery with Shinji's Bankai. And honestly, I think that's good. I think it makes people interested. And I think we should leave it at that. I did have a problem with the still frame shot. I felt like there could have been more shown to it. At first, you had it really good with the comic book effect, all the people getting hit with the headshots and whatnot, and then doing like this pan up shot of all those people like just getting killed with like a shaky effect. Personally, it wasn't for me, but it was short enough to where it didn't bother me too much. But considering how hyped up this event was, or especially in the trailer that they gave us, I did feel it was a little bit lackluster, but that was the only part that was lackluster. I feel like I'm talking about the hollow pills a little bit too much, but can we talk about the potential of Yumichika actually having a Bankai here? And nobody's kind of mentioned it. There might have been like one or two people on Twitter, but regardless, like, nobody's really talked about it. Like, we know Ikkaku has a Bankai, right? And all the pills were sent out to people with Bankais. And if somebody touches that pill without a Bankai, nothing's going to happen, e.g. Omaida. However, we had two pills for Ikkaku and Yumichika. We know that Ikkaku's dissolved. But then when I looked at the next frame, you know, they're both looking at their hands, right, to see like, oh, okay, like, that's cool. And Yumichika does say, we don't have to worry about your Bankai being taken. However, as he's looking at his hand, he also flips it like that and nothing drops. And I'm assuming that this is like, it can really go either way. I don't think there's enough evidence to suggest that he has a Bankai. But do you know what? Like, we're also put in a position to which there is a little bit of evidence to suggest that he also has a Bankai as well. So, you know, why is he looking in his hand and then just does that and nothing drops? You know, it's the little things that, like, I'm noticing. And why is he look... Again, it's weird. So, does Shimochika have a Bankai? Yeah, I don't know really what to say other than that. Like, does he? Does he? Guys, help me out here. Then, of course, we have Master Masculine appear with the GOAT. The absolute peak of male performance. James, be it my cameo. Except, I hope that I don't look like him because I'm not a Greek god. And that is, of course, James being a god amongst men. So, unfortunately, that isn't my cameo, but I would like to believe that Kubo thought of me when he made this character, considering he's a fanboy, and I'm a fanboy myself. So I'll have my headcanon, thank you very much. But regardless of the memes, if anyone doesn't know, and it's a little bit of a spoiler, but James is actually the Sternritter S, which is the Master Masculine's creator. That being said, I appreciate the original fight with the 3v1 with Shuhei, Yumichika, and Ikkaku, because we didn't get that in the manga, and I felt like it was important to get those things, and it makes me even more excited for that 1v7, not 1v7, 5v7 with, like, the Shinigami versus the Quincy towards the end of the arc. It's making me really excited for that. In fact, like, the one thing that I really wanted within this arc is looking more and more plausible by the day. So very excited for that. And of course, I did like Ikkaku getting his shot. Yumichika, lol. But Shuhei, actually, again, nobody hates Shuhei at all. He's a very good fighter, and he's proven to be a good fighter as well, especially with his Shikai abilities and his versatility with his Shikai, I think, was really good. And Mask, of course, getting hit was great as well. Not a good look for Mask for anime onlys, but hey. And then, of course, before we get into Ichigo, we have Bambietta, which, of course, nobody can talk about this fight without talking about the Riz music. And Shinji is just like me, for real, because that's what I'd be playing if me and her were ever alone. So, Rizin her up. And I guess it really fits Shinji's character in some way. I did like the effects and played exactly how it did in the manga, telling Komamura to go and do his thing because Komamura is not worried about Bambi. Whatever ability I'll say that Komamura has, he needs to go focus it on Yuha, right? That's his prerogative right now. So I completely understand. And also Komamura understanding that he needs to get out as well, considering what Shinji's Shikai actually does. So Komamura to know what Shinji's ability does. I know it's kind of self-explanatory that, like, they're all captains, they should all know. But the fact that he knew what he was thinking and just dipped without question was a pretty good synergy in what I believe. Shinji just absolutely caught massive dubs in this episode, because if you were a manga reader, Shinji just definitely got no love whatsoever. Like, yeah, he did some things with Bambietta, but it was so, like, short-lived. So to add the Bankai bit and then go straight to the Bambietta thing, I do think Shinji definitely got a massive glow-up and a lot of appreciation, because this episode really did redeem a lot of his character. And just the absolute trolling that he did as well, really taking cues from Aizen. Or maybe Aizen learned it from Shinji, who knows? But Shinji was always a troll, and he proved it again in this episode, and he absolutely dominated. However, Bambi's not an easy girl to tame. And I told you, Shinji, you ain't him. I'm him. So, that aside, yes, Bambietta, I did love her character acting. I know, unironically, I loved her stroppiness, her tantrums. I loved the versatility within the voice actor. I think she's just a fun character overall. She's very simplistic in her character as well. And I think that's what makes her so lovable and so cool and so powerful and frightening at the same time as well. She's predictable, but unpredictable depending on her emotions. So she's getting angry, like, she's gonna explode. Like, I know that's the trait, James, I know. So I love that fight. And again, the music was just, like, it was so out of place that, like, it shouldn't be there, but it was so good being there because it fit, like, unironically. So that being said, let's talk about Ichigo Kurosaki towards the end in the Valley of the Path of the Soul King vessel, whatever that is, right? Isoran Sando is I think it's called. Now, many people have theories, and many people are saying, oh, is it the almighty? Power scalers are absolutely beating their absolute shafts to this. And I'm going to really be the bearer of bad news, and I don't think Ichigo has the almighty whatsoever. I think it is extremely simplistic, and I don't want to really make a theory, potentially, because I know that there's going to be a lot more that if I make a theory now, next episode, it's going to be completely debunked. But it is very simple to me what is going on within this situation. So what we know is that Ichigo is going down this path to see if he can be a vessel for the Soul King, right? To push the boundaries of being a Soul Reaper, right? Now, granted, if you know what you know about the light novels, we know that Ichigo was a candidate for the Soul King, but that doesn't mean he is the Soul King, and that doesn't mean he has a script either. It just means he's eligible for these things, right? He's a vessel, and he can take it if he so chooses to go down that route. Then again, he doesn't really have a choice, I don't think. But anyway, on the assumption that things don't change within the manga, and the manga is still the way things are going to go, Ichigo isn't going to have multiple eyes, and he's not going to have the Almighty. What this essentially is to me is that Ichigo is getting a lot of flashbacks, and he has this yellow aura that he gets, insinuating that this is the Soul King entering his body and showing him the past. And that's why Ichigo's eyes are like that, because momentarily he is a vessel for the Soul King to show him what he needs to show him. And thus, if the Soul King's abilities are in Ichigo at this point in time, his body is going to somewhat change. His eye doesn't change, they're just very faded ocular representations, right? And they are in literally the same positions as the Soul King's irises. That doesn't mean he has the Almighty, it just means that the Soul King is showing Ichigo the past. And that's simply it. And it is just a representation of that. Ichigo doesn't have the Almighty. He doesn't choose to have a script. He doesn't choose any of this. He's not absorbed the Soul King. Because the moment that Yuha absorbed the Soul King was the moment that Yuha got multiple eyes. And considering that Yuha is a descendant of the Soul King, he's going to have some Soul King-like DNA or, you know, spiritual energy in him. So the three eyes make sense, of course. The hand makes sense. Gerard with no eyes because is the heart makes sense. And of course, we can't forget about Panada, but some people who are anime onlys probably don't know about these characters yet. These guys are descendants of the Soul King, right? Now, granted, Fullbringers do have a tiny, tiny, tiny fragment of the Soul King in them, if you've again read the novels. But in this case, Ichigo doesn't have multiple eyes throughout the series, considering he has like this tiny fragment of the Soul King in him. He's a Fullbringer, etc. The Fullbringers don't have different irises. This is simply Ichigo going down this path to see if the Soul King deems Ichigo worthy. And in order to do that, he needs to take Ichigo's body like a vessel to show him, and to see if his body can, one, take it, right? But to also show him the past. And that's simply it. There's no Almighty. I think we should nip that in the bud. And I'm happy to be proven wrong. But I do think the theory is a bit silly based off absolutely nothing. Oh, he's got four eyes. Yeah, but they're not even on him, mate. Like, if they were solid and they were on him, then fair enough. But these were just like very faded representations. Now, before I end this off, people want to talk about, oh, James, why do you keep bringing up Tokinada? Yes, okay, I get it, right? I get it. It's not Tokinada, right? The only reason why that theory came into fruition in the first place is because, one, we saw the trailer, right? We didn't have these episodes, I guess you could say, context, right? We know that from the light novels, the Tokinada family or the Susanoo Nashiro family were involved with the Soul King's crystallization. We'll say the least. But it does seem like, and again, with the standing in the river, gave me the vibe that that was Tokinada taking this sword out of Uetsu's, like, little storage of swords. Obviously, that isn't the case. There was a lot of coincidences there, but it seems like it wasn't. However, I did find it weird that the Soul King would essentially execute himself, if that makes sense, or tear apart his own limbs. But it would seem through these flashbacks that he does, in fact, remove his own limbs. In fact, it shows four whirlpools, right? One Wakamundo, one World of the Living, one Soul Society. And you can assume that the middle one is the Soul Palace. Or, I guess, the keystone being him, like that whirlpool is him holding all of them together. But it also seems to me from the grainy photos, again, could be wrong, that each limb, or not each limb, but some of the limbs have gone in different whirlpools. So it would make sense, some of the arms went to Soul Society, obviously Kamikaze, or Kamikaki, I forgot what his name was. Mimihagi, James. You got Mimihagi, you got wherever, you know, Panada went. You got wherever Gerard went, and then whatever is in the World of the Living. We don't know. Something could have gone in the World of the Living. Maybe that was the fragments for the Fullbringers. Who knows? But it seems like some of the limbs did go in different whirlpools. And maybe that was the Soul King's way of like separating his body parts. So maybe the royal family couldn't get a hold of each of them is a possibility. And maybe that was the way he deemed fit of which was able to create stability. I don't know. But it seems like it's going that direction. So that's what the whirlpools represent. I don't know what the arrows represent. To be honest, like, I saw some of the comments, I agreed with some of the theories. I don't really have like a solid mindset on it, and that's good. I think that that's cool because I want to learn and I want to see more before I start like wrapping my head around things. However, I don't think it is foreshadowing to Yuha's defeat. I just don't, like, it just seems like a tool of which is there to create the whirlpool itself. But I am interested in the key that was used to dismember the body parts, if it was used to dismember the body parts, because you see the arm like holding onto the key, but it's also detached itself. So that's interesting. I don't know. So that's my kind of take and theory on it. Tell me what your guys' thoughts in the comment section down below. This has been a long discussion slash review, so I'm going to leave it off with that. I hope you guys enjoyed. Hit the like and subscribe, all that good stuff. And of course, with that being said, I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day. Be handsome as always, people. Peace out.